For instance, ravens. I used to have to go up to Snowdonia to see a raven. Now they're all over the place. And of course, here there's a jay. I've noticed them coming into towns more and more. Foxes, of course. Everyone knows they come into towns. But peregrine falcons, very exotic. There's hardly a city in the UK that doesn't now have nesting peregrines. Badgers seem to be creeping into our towns too. But some animals have increased to levels where they're starting to damage the habitat. And when that happens, we have to consider management.
I think, though, an awful lot of people can sit back and think that conservation is someone else's job, that they can solve the problem. But we can all do our bit to help. You know, there are 16 million gardens in the UK. But the great thing is, half the adults in the UK help by feeding their garden birds. They spend hundreds of millions of pounds on bird seeds and feeders, and that means that numbers of some birds have gone up. Blue tits 4%, great tits by 23%, and the greater spotted woodpecker by 58%. But gardens are such an important resource. If you put all the gardens together, the area they cover is bigger than all the national nature reserves. It's as big as Oxfordshire. So we really do have to use this resource for wildlife. Brilliant that everyone's feeding their birds, but I think we can all do just that little bit more. We can help insects, we can plant suitable flowers. You know, there are so many things that we can do. So let's all decide right now on the last show of this Springwatch, this series, to do something extra in your garden. And there are lots of ideas on our website. But, you know, when you think of mammals that have increased in numbers, what do we think of, as you said, deer? I mean, we've certainly seen plenty of deer here at Minsmere, the red deer in particular. Well, Yolo Williams went up to the west coast of Scotland to see deer for himself.
It's 5 a.m. and cameraman Mark Sharman prepares his kit. Assisting him today is Andy Malcolm, a man with 20 years' experience in the Poltalloch Hills. But I'm hoping this is going to be my secret weapon. Our mission today, to get close to one of Scotland's most iconic animals. We're off to stalk some deer.
Well, Andy, getting up early, I can understand if you're going looking for wildlife, but why all of this tweed?
Because you look great, Yolo.
You silver-tongued devil, you.
No, it's comfort, it's camouflage. I say wear what you're comfortable in, and we're all comfortable in tweeds over here, so why not just wear them?
Well, I feel very dapper, I have to say.
Yeah.
Right, let's go. You lead on, I'll follow.
But it's not just about looking dapper. Tweed is traditional Highland camouflage, and the colour depends on where you live. Down here, on the wet west coast, we're using green. We're also relying on Andy's deer stalking skills to get us close enough to film these beautiful animals.
Four hinds.
Four, yeah.
Red deer is one of the big animals.
Very alert, very spooked. You can see they knew we were here long before we came over the brow of the hill, because the ears were turning, the noses were twitching constantly, and they were moving away. It's their smell and their hearing. They can turn around at 1 or 2 kilometres. You wonder how on earth they've seen you or smelt you, and yet there they are looking straight at you.
Amazing animals. So when you're stalking deer, the wind, the direction of the wind, is one of the most important things.
Absolutely. You can't hope to approach anything with the wind at your back.
So really the wind needs to be right in your face.
Yeah, it's not always possible, but you want to begin a stalk with the wind to you rather than the back of you. If you don't get it right, you'll just be watching backsides all day running away from you.
There are 2 native species of deer in Scotland, red and roe. At this time of year, they're having their young. And that's what we'd really love to film. But then,
pull the eagle just on the top of the hill there, just breaking the skyline now. See it?
Are you sure it's a goldie?
Yeah, it is a goldie, yeah.
Well, you're right. Yeah, 2 of them.
There are 2 of them, 2 goldies. It's a bit of a bonus. We've got 2 golden eagles up here as well. They're huge birds and they're struggling to get lift.
this early in the morning. If we hadn't put them up, I think they'd just sit until the sun was up. Then you get these thermals and they can rise up easily, but as it is, it's a lot of effort for them.
Over the hill, we find a group of young roebucks playing at rutting. The roe deer rut won't start for another month, but these yearlings are too young to be serious contenders, but they're raring to give it a go. Breaking up the fun, a buck chases the young guns off his territory. We keep going on our mission to find some calves.
Looks like a hind and a calf and a yearling.
So with ideal conditions, the wind in your face, how close could you get to a red deer like that?
I wouldn't like to be any further than about 150 odd metres.
Which is about what we would need to get to film to get a good shot.
I would say so.
Yeah, it's very similar.
And Mark gets his shot. It's lovely to see this beautiful red deer calf with its spots. He's probably just over a week old, and already he's quick on his feet and full of life, which he needs to be if he's going to survive in this tough environment.
I think Yolo looked rather dapper in his tweed, and he's joining us now. Where is he? Yolo? Oh, my word!
Hello, Michaela, how are you? I thought standards had dropped rather, so I thought I'd raise them again. I've got to be very careful how I sit down.
I feel so underdressed.
Quite right, too.
You're looking lovely.
Thank you very much.
Are you pleased to escape the midges I felt for you last night? Oh, my word, it was a midge fest, wasn't it?
It was a midge fest, but I don't get bitten. I'm really lucky I don't get bitten. And I have to say, the Poltalloch estate, the Laird and everybody there give us such a welcome. And, of course, deer stalking is a big thing for them. You know, it brings in revenue, it keeps deer numbers down as well, so they've got a really fine balance there.
Now, at the beginning of the series, you said you were going to go in search of the Scottish wild cat.
Yes.
You know, incredibly rare animal, rarer than the tiger now. Did you have any luck?
Well, yes, we had a tip-off very early on, and a lady called Jean Howarth phoned us, and she said, I get a wild cat coming into my garden, so she puts out these cameras, and here it is. This is the cat she sees in her garden, and we thought, is that or is that not a wild cat? And immediately after, we had another tip-off further down the peninsula there, and a chap called Ewan took us out, and we put some bait out, and we tried to get the cat in. Eventually it came. It took a long, long time. It was the early hours of the morning. There it is, up on the wall. And again, is that a wild cat? We really weren't sure at all whether either of them were, because the wild cat is supposed to have this very broad face, supposed to have a very thick, blunt tail, it's supposed to have rings on it and a black end. And of course, the difficulty is they will breed with domestic cats. And if you've got a hybrid, this is a true wild cat now.
You can see the tail.
That's right.
I guess it's quite easy to tell the difference between a true wild cat and a domestic cat. But as you say, it's when they crossbreed, when they're hybrids.
It's very, very difficult.
It
is difficult. And bear in mind, domestic cats are descended from the African wild cat. The Scottish wild cat is descended from the North European wild cat. So they're different subspecies, but they will interbreed. And that's the difficulty. And there's a project starting now to look for true, genetically true wild cats. Are there any left? We really don't know. To try and find if there are, and if there are, well, we'll have to see what measures need to be taken after that.
And of course, we don't know the numbers either, do we?
We have no idea. We have no idea. But if anybody out there knows of a wild cat anywhere, please get in touch. Please phone. There's a link on our website to this new wild cat project. So hopefully we can pass those on, and in who knows how many years, maybe 5 years, we'll have a much better idea.
Well, I must say thank you very much for brightening my day and your tartan. You're looking very smart. Well, you'd be extremely lucky to find a wild cat in your garden. But if you've got a large garden pond, you might be lucky to see a stickleback in the water. But did you know that they have remarkable mating habits? And if you're a male stickleback, you've got blue eyes and a bit of a ruddy complexion, then you've got a better chance of getting a mate.
Another spring.
It's springtime in the garden.
Is on its way.
While the kids have all the time in the world.
Another April.
It's another story in the pond.
Another May.
Here, the race is on to breed. A male three-spined stickleback. His bright blue eyes and blood-red belly signal that he's in the mood for love. But first, there's work to be done. He needs to build a nest. Male sticklebacks are the ultimate modern men and take sole responsibility for this task. A discarded plant pot is the base he needs. Pondweed and leaf debris abound. They're the perfect nest-building materials. The pond is full of new life. Tiny water fleas called Daphnia bloom in the rising temperatures. Miniature copepods scavenge for algae. While the sticklebat works, a mayfly larvae looks on. Hard graft is almost done. He releases spiggin, a gluey secretion from his kidneys, and cements the vegetation. Job done. A female observes from the shadows. She's fat with eggs. But even so, he fails to woo her. Luckily, she's not the only female in the pond. The next one looks more keen. Mouth open and spines erect, he dances around her. With her head raised, she signals that she's ready. He shows her the tunnel in which she needs to spawn. Then she lays an enormous clutch of as many as 200 eggs. A well-constructed nest is crucial to keep the eggs together. Once he's fertilized the eggs, the affair is over. But he'll stay close by to guard the nest. After 10 days, the eggs are almost ready to hatch. The male has kept his vigil. He fans continuously, driving oxygen-rich water over the eggs. Finally, his hard work pays off. Almost unrecognizable as fish, these tiny babies are still attached to their yolk sacs. They'll stay within the nest for the next few days, gradually morphing into tiny fry. Our male will remain an attentive father until his offspring leave the nest. After that, his job is done. Now the fry must fend for themselves. So don't forget the super dad hard at work in your pond when you're relaxing in your garden this spring.
What a fascinating little fish. But the male, let's see, blue eyes, check. Ruddy complexion. But do you have plenty of spiggin?
I'm always producing spiggin.